almost over. We're going to have a really nice panel discussion with really incredible photographers. And we wanted to focus on portrait photography and the power of portraits and really delve into how the minds of these three photographers work out a portrait situation, how they solve the problems of making great portraits and get tips and tricks on how we do that. So of the three panelists, we have three Nikon ambassadors with us today. Let me introduce to the stage first Charmi Pena, who specializes in Indian weddings. Jerry, you need to whoop that up a bit more. Oh, wait, but he's coming up. This gentleman is a wedding and portrait photographer. He does fashion work as well. And he is a local Las Vegas person. He's probably won more awards than anyone at the WPPI show, Grand Awards. He is a great friend. He is a great technician. And he's so meticulous with the way he shoots and poses. Let me introduce the Nikon stage. Nikon ambassador Jerry Ghionis. My brother.
Thank you, mate. Thanks so much.
With the bad accent. And this next lady is, I'm just such a big fan of. We've known each other for quite a long time now. She's a fashion photographer and filmmaker, directs TV commercials out of Texas. Nikon ambassador Dixie Dixon.
Woo! That was very loud. I know, right? Crazy. Thank you.
So, just in case, because I know you all, anybody out there viewing or here in the venue viewing doesn't know who you are. Let's start with you, Charmi. Tell everybody a little bit about yourself and what you do.
So I'm from New Jersey. I shoot mostly Indian weddings. I shoot about, well, I shot 30 last year. I'm going to shoot only 20 this year. And I focus a lot on multi-day weddings. Yeah.
Mr. Ghionis.
Well, I'm actually happy that I'm the rose between the two thorns. So I just want to say that to start off with, so thank you very much.
That was carefully planned out.
It was carefully planned. Thank you very much. But my name is Jerry Ghionis. I've been photographing professionally for 25 years, born and raised in Melbourne, Australia, hence the accent. I'm also American. I'm also Greek. I have an identity crisis. but I love what I do, and it's an honor to be here with these ladies here as well, so thank you.
Ms. Dixon,
yes.
A little background on where you come from, what you do, and how you do it.
Yeah, I'm Dixie Dixon. I'm a commercial fashion and advertising photographer. Believe it or not, I am based out of Texas, and I have spent the past 10 years traveling all around the world, photographing different models and campaigns, and it's been such a fun adventure, so I'm really excited to be here today.
I think one thing that we share, maybe while you're sitting here or tuning in, is a passion for photographing people. And what I really want to delve into, we'll talk a little bit of technology and lenses and things like that, but not so much f-stops and shutter speeds, is how you connect with your subjects. And there's such a diverse group of people that we all photograph, right? I photograph children at the Ronald McDonald House, and I know we do fashion here, and we do portraits, and you, Charmi, just did a program that talks about how you photograph your children and family members. And I really want to delve into it, but outside of when you're photographing your family, and Jerry, let me start with you. Do you research your subjects when someone is presented to you that you have to photograph? Do you do any research? Do you follow up? Do you check them out online? What do you do?
Well, here's the thing. If you're photographing a wedding, I believe you have to connect with them personally and emotionally. And I think that you have to laugh with someone before you cry with someone. Mm-hmm. So to be able to ask poignant questions to not only the couple, the parents, and even the best friends, you get to quickly find out what's important to them and what's valuable to them as well. Mm-hmm. So for example, when a couple walks in, sometimes a wedding photographer will show a price list within minutes of meeting that person. Mm-hmm. Whereas I won't have any wedding albums on the table in front of them. I will connect with them. I'll say, you know, what drink would you like? Not if you would like a drink. And then all of a sudden we start speaking, and then I might say, you know, a bit of small talk first, and then say something like, tell me the moment you looked at your fiance and you knew you wanted to spend the rest of your life with him. Mm-hmm. Now, sometimes I get tears before I show a single photograph. Then they don't even know that moment, actually, they haven't recognized that moment. And all of a sudden, this whole conversation gets born with just one question that actually involved empathy.
That's awesome. Charmi, I know I've heard you speak about this. You connect with your brides right away, right?
Yep.
How do you do that? How do you make that connection to get to that point when you're photographing them, you know you're doing the right job?
So most of my clients never come in to meet me in person before the wedding. They're all professionals and very demanding jobs, and so they almost never see my face. And so I really have to take advantage of our phone calls. And so immediately when I talk to them, I actually don't ask them about themselves at all. I ask them to start talking to me about what they're planning. And they'll give themselves away over the call where they're saying, you know, it's really important to me that my mom be really happy. It's really important to me that my husband get this one thing, like, you know, this groom's cake that I hate, but I know he loves it and I want him to have it. So I just kind of give them openings to keep talking about themselves, and they'll give away to me what is important to them, and then I'll use those little hints that they give me to dig a little deeper. And then when I do meet them in person, I try to always keep it as casual as possible with them, because I know that it's awkward. They're not, my clients are not models. They look like models on their wedding day, but they're not prepared to have a camera in their face. And so when I show up, if I'm able to, you know, go back to our inside joke from our phone calls or whatever and keep them laughing, I think I just realized that while I take romantic photos, portraits of my couples, most of the portraits I take are like joy. There's a lot of laughing and a lot of happiness, like overt happiness. And I think that's because I let them lead the way on what makes them happy, and then I keep on that subject.
Right, and one of the things I've seen on your website and your bio is it's so important for you to make them understand within the pictures, you're showing them the joy of their life, not just that they're pretty or, you know, you've made a great picture. And we're talking, they're talking about specific wedding in the business, but this applies to anybody that you're going to photograph in the way of a portrait, 100%. Right? I know, Dixie, when you first meet a subject that you want to shoot, you have a way of connecting with them. How do you do that?
I do, absolutely. I mean, it starts even before the shoot. I research all of my clients on social media to see what their favorite music is, to see what kind of food that they like, all these different things that they are very personal about them. And so when they walk in to a portrait session, I always have their favorite music playing because it creates an instant connection. I feel
right.
like people really,
puts them in a good mood.
Yes, it puts them at ease. And then I always give them a huge hug. I'm a big hugger. Mm-hmm. And so that just sets the tone for this great connection during the shoot. I think it sort of brings their guards down
right. So
that they can then express themselves in all of the images.
And you give great hugs, I know from experience. Have you ever walked into anybody that wouldn't hug back? Does that sort of set you off?
I have had that happen
try another
once.
Strategy if that doesn't happen.
If only she had a beautiful smile. That would really, really help you, Dixie. You should work on that.
What if someone is immediately standoffish from that hug?
Oh, it just means you have to spend a lot more time during the portrait session. If they give you one of those side hugs, you know that you're going to have to spend a lot more time getting them out of their element so they can then express themselves. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, we live in a world of selfies, right? That sort of become your own individual portraits when you point the camera back at you. Mm-hmm. And Jerry, you and I were talking about this. I want to take you to take lead on this. But how do you impress the value of a photograph versus a selfie, like a great portrait? What makes a great portrait over a selfie, or the value of that photo?
Well, here's the thing. We're living in a world, wouldn't you agree, that anyone over the age of 12 living in a first world country has a phone, which means they have a camera on their person, mm-hmm. which means that we've become the most popular hobby in the world. Think about it. Mm-hmm. The millions of photographs that get taken every day.
Yes.
So all of a sudden now, everyone's got a microphone and everyone thinks they can sing, but that's not the case. But here is the thing, a bad photograph of someone you love is still meaningful.
Yes.
A good photograph, a great moment, technically crafted, something that exposes something that even the client didn't even know about, well, that's even more meaningful. As an example, I had a young lady ring me up. She basically says, look, I have three children. I have a husband that works 24/7, and I want to remind him of how important our relationship is and the connection between us. So we're coming to Las Vegas. We're going to leave the kids at home. I want you to create something that is a reminder that I should be like the center of his world, and he might lose me. That's what she said to me after some conversation. And this guy's a really, really big, burly, strong guy. But, you know, a little bit soft around the edges. So I had him in a chair, actually like this, with one spotlight, not dissimilar to what we see here on the Nikon stage. He had his hand out. She's holding the hands with both hands. Wind is flying her dress everywhere, and she's looking into the camera. Mm-hmm. Now, when they saw this picture, I mean, you think of how meaningful this is to the couple, and I actually even told the story of what I was trying to create and remind them of, and guess what? I just happened to sell a 40 by 60. And again, you know, I say, if not for the love, for the money, but hopefully both.
Right. When making a portrait, you have a decision to either bring somebody somewhere or take them to a studio. And I want to talk a little bit about the differences in the way you approach things from the sense of an environmental portrait versus a studio portrait. Dixie, how do you dig into each of those scenarios and what is your thought process in making that happen?
Yeah, I mean, I always prefer environments, definitely, because I feel like the studio, I think people get a little bit more nervous in the studio, especially when you're shooting people that aren't, you know, professional models. Mm-hmm. So if I can get them in their element, in their favorite environment, there's things that happen on location that you can't quite predict. I call them
very true.
Happy accidents, like when the lens hits the light in that perfect moment where the sun is just, you know, shining in their eyes or whatever it is. That's really hard to get those moments in studio. Mm-hmm. So if at all possible, I like to shoot on location as much as possible. In studio, if I am doing a studio portrait, I love to use natural light a lot of times. Sometimes I'll use strobe for fashion, but man, that natural light, just the way that it falls on the subject's face, I feel like natural light was the light that was made for humans, because it just brings out their inner beauty and personality.
Charmi, Jerry, Charmi, you first. Where do you prefer to shoot?
I mean, I'm mostly at weddings, so I actually love being outside.
Right.
I'm always running away from the studio idea, even. I want my clients to feel a sense of where they were on their wedding day, so I think environmental portraits are a big deal for everything that I'm doing, so being outside and being away from studio and studio lighting is big. But I will admit to you that lately I'm a little bit attracted to studio lighting, and I may have roped a couple people in to force them to let me experiment on them just for fun. I think the studio experience can be fun in a different way.
Mm-hmm. And I like Dixie's thought. It's in a controlled environment. You know, you can do things in a controlled way, but the beauty of the environment is the unpredictability of it. Jerry, which do you prefer?
There's no preference. Well, here's the thing. If someone said, well, what kind of lighting do you like? And some people call themselves strobists. I'm a natural light photographer, whatever. And I'm a photographer. And I use the light that's appropriate for the job that I need to get done.
Right.
So it could be window light. It could be the ice light that I invented. It could be a speed light. It could be a softbox. It could be strobes, reflectors. It could be anything. It doesn't really matter. I believe a photographer should be a complete photographer, understand how to sculpt and shape light, and I think should be well-versed in those obvious continuous light, strobes, you know, natural light, all that kind of stuff, and to be able to use what's around them. So after all, when you're working really quickly, you know, you need to get it done, and that's important.
And I think that's a great important point. I mean, to me, the make or break on photos, 9 times out of 10, is the quality of the light. Charmi, speak to the quality of the light. I've seen some of your pictures are phenomenal. Fighting for those times, when is the best times for you to be shooting? And, you know, especially in a wedding environment where you're controlled with time.
So, because of what I shoot, I can't even have a favorite time of day.
I have to be ready for anything.
Yep. There are definitely times where I have to do a couple portraits at noon. And so I've had to learn to embrace the harshest of lights and make it beautiful.
And how are you doing that?
Yeah. So, you know, this really is 15 minutes after the sun came up over the horizon. There's like barely any light. So when it comes to quality of light, as long as I can get my subject in some light, I will make it be the quality I need. Just maybe not an overhead tungsten bulb. We can skip that one.
No, understood. So I find myself that when I go into a studio to shoot a portrait, I shoot one lens. I kind of restrict myself, and because maybe I was born to believe that a 105 is the focal length to have in a studio.
Gorgeous.
And I feel restricted. So outdoors, you have an opportunity for other lenses. Dixie, talk about your favorite lenses. I want all of you to talk about the lenses that you use in the different situations.
Yeah.
So everybody understands what your approach is to this.
I am obsessed with the 105,
right.
Just mentioned.
The 105, 1.4, right.
Yes, that lens with the FTZ adapter with the Nikon Z7 is the most beautiful portrait I've ever created, and especially with window light, with natural light, because you get that beautiful look where the eyes are just tack sharp. You can see every single eyelash, and then everything else just falls out of focus so beautifully. Mm-hmm. Oh, it gives me chills when I use that lens. So that's usually my go-to for headshots. I'll use the 35 if I'm trying to capture like a model within an environment to capture the cool background with the model. The 85 is a really great lens as well to use. I love those long lenses, especially for headshots, though.
I think when the 105 came out, the 85 I stopped using for the most part. But Jerry, what lenses do you use? I know you use a ton of different lenses.
Yeah, I typically bring 5 to, if I'm shooting a wedding, for example, and then maybe a little bit different on a fashion or portrait shoot. But 70 to 200 is my favorite lens, 2.8. Mm-hmm. I just think everyone looks prettier with a longer compression, you know, longer focal length. Probably my second favorite, 105, 1.4. The 105 micro, I love to crop in really close and dissect faces. Mm-hmm. And that being said, there's times where I might shoot, you know, I have 5 lenses in my bag and just shoot with one the whole day. Mm-hmm. But really, it's the same with lighting. I find, like, how beautiful is my wife, by the way? I just want to say something like that.
Yeah, it's very.
sorry, I just, Melissa. My peripheral vision, I'm like, how beautiful is my wife?
Melissa Ghionis is definitely your better half.
I agree. But I think it's fun. I think the fact that we have so many choices to use. Mm-hmm. And now with mirrorless, it's actually bringing more fun to the equation because you can see what you're doing live, you can review it very quickly, you can magnify it quickly. It's more efficient, more fun. Yeah.
Charmi zooms fixed. Do you have a preference? What do you run with?
I'm a straight up prime girl. I don't even own any zooms anymore.
I don't either.
Yeah, none.
She's an elitist.
It's funny. Zooms, prime.
We're just better at things. I don't know what to say.
She's like, just walk back, walk closer. What's
it makes
the big
me
deal?
Think. I think I know what my frame is going to look like before I pick up my camera. Mm-hmm. So a 35 and an 85 and now a 105, those are seared into my brain in a way that I know what I'm going to do before the camera's up. And so that's why I love prime so much. They keep me efficient and they keep me moving. but I will say since the 105 1.4 came out, I used to be a 35-85 girl strictly. I didn't even own any other lenses because I just refused. But I bought that 105 1.4 and oh my goodness, my poor 85 must feel so left out.
If I can just put Nikon on the spot right now, can you make like a 10?
So anyway, the next question I have for you guys, we're not going to put Nikon. We're not
going to
put Nikon on the spot.
Nikon. A 10 mil. That's a whole nother 200. 1.95. That's my request.
Okay. Yeah, we're going to work on that. We'll release that next year.
Going to put it out there.
Let's delve a little bit more. So you have your lens choices. We'll talk a little bit more about mirrorless versus DSLR in a little bit. But let's talk about the moment now where you start a portrait shoot and you have to start making somebody feel important and connected. And you all of a sudden become a director. And Jerry, when you were doing your live satellite yesterday, you went through this whole posing exercise. And maybe I'll put you on the spot. How did you show people how to pose or posing them yesterday?
Well, I mean, all the audience right now, I could actually pose you all at the same time very, very easily. And that's just simply getting you to mirror me. So if you're playing at home, do it as well. Okay, you feel a bit silly.
Do this?
Okay, I'll stand up.
All right, please.
Okay. Everybody stand up, please. Whole audience, stand up. You are my bride right now, and I want to make you look really beautiful. So I want you to mirror. You guys mirror me as well.
I'm doing
ready?
This too. Okay.
We're going to turn our body. The light's coming from this direction. We turn our body away from the light. Then we point the toe towards the camera, slide the heel back in. You notice that all the weight's on your back leg. Shift your butt back, bend the knee in, shoulders back, lean the chest forward, turn the face to the light, hands on the hips for a bit of attitude, chin up for the light, and have a bit of a laugh with me.
Wow.
There you go.
Very nice. Very nice.
Now, you thought I'd get embarrassed, but I didn't.
No, I didn't at all, because I know you well enough to know that you wouldn't. But, Dixie, talk to me about the directing process. How do you keep your subjects engaged in the middle of a shoot? Because I know they take some time.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of things going on around you sometimes, but how do you keep
Definitely.
That connection going?
Yeah, I think that's the most important part. With a lot of these fashion productions, there's so many people on set. There might be 20 people on set. So for me to hone in and get in the zone with the model that I'm shooting, I'm really focused. A lot of people will tap me on the shoulder because I literally don't hear anything else that's going on when I'm shooting. The music's playing, and really and truly, I shower the model with compliments. Mm-hmm. So I don't really pose. I tend to shoot through moments. So I might shoot, 50 frames in order to get that shot that I'm looking for, mm-hmm. but it's really to get the model going and kind of moving and in her zone so that I can capture her personality. That's kind of the way that I like to shoot and capture that sort of mood out of the model. And really, it's just keeping that positive energy and surrounding yourself with really amazing, positive people.
Charmi, are there any tips you want to share? When you're one-on-one with somebody, not a big crew around, how you're staying engaged with the subject?
In my situation, I try always to start them with something light. I want them to just talk to each other about something. I'll bring up something that happened early in the day, and I want them to talk about it because just them connecting to each other is a really good start for a portrait session for me. And so if I can get them to talk to each other and to connect, then when I ask them to kind of get a little out of their comfort zone, they're already calm and they're already feeling good. Mm-hmm. And so it's a little easier to transition from, I'm in a happy place and I'm looking at the person I love, to now I have to look at this person or do something editorial, because most of my clients want a mix. They want, candid looking stuff, and they want portraits that are perfect for their parents' mantle, but then they want editorial stuff, and so there has to be a flow so that they, you can't do editorial stuff first. That's very awkward for people who are not models. And so I make sure that I'm starting with the things that are easiest for them, and then we flow into the things that might be a little more difficult, but they're already comfortable, so they're ready to go.
Right. it's funny because Jerry, just you're truly a master at posing, and I'm not joking when I say that, because you really do get people. I see you move them a millimeter, or shift something just slightly, and it works that way. Yet Dixie, you and I tend to be more of the, run and gun kind of, photographers that they will flow into the moment. And the one thing I found when it came to photographing children, especially the children at the Ronald McDonald House, most of my time when I first connected with them wasn't spent picking up the camera and shooting. It could be wrestling on the floor. It could be playing Legos. It could be doing building blocks. It could be playing in a fake tent inside the main family room of the Ronald McDonald House before I ever pick up the camera. And I found that when you do that and you can engage on a different level, get them interested, you take away the barrier of this big thing that comes up in front of your face. And then you try to carry over the fun from that. And you lose a few pictures that way because you're constantly shooting fast, but it does help you engage, a lot better with the subject. So,
Can I make a quick comment?
Yep.
I think it's important for people to understand, especially those who are watching at home and those in this room, is that posing is often considered a dirty word. I think many of us think of posing as constricting, and it's not quite right. So what I suggest is that when we pose, you not only pose to be flattering, but you pose to be purposeful. You can actually say something with the way of tilting of the face, the eyes down and everything. But I consider it like we construct, and then when we get the emotion out, if the emotion comes out, it makes it less perfect, then the emotion beats the perfection.
Right.
I prefer both. Mm-hmm. If I can get both, as in something very flattering, but very meaningful and purposeful at the same time, then fantastic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Charmi, I want you to dig a little bit deeper in all of you in the quality of light thing, because I know we brought it up already and you mentioned how you shoot in the worst times of day. What other tools are you using outside maybe a speed light to help control the light? Do you have any tips in the way of light?
I have this giant 56-inch scrim, and I use it to block all kinds of terrible light all the time. I feel bad for my assistant. It's humongous.
So the scrim is taking away the harsh light from up above?
Yeah, so it's almost creating a softbox, a gigantic softbox. But I always keep it in my bag just in case. And it's come in really handy. We actually had to do a getting ready completely in the dark this year. And I'm not a fan of getting ready completely in the dark. She wanted to get ready at 5:45 in the morning. Sun didn't come up till 7:15.
What light are you using then? Is it just the ambient light in the room? Or?
No, so I rigged, me and my assistant rigged with suction cups.
Jerry rigged it.
two video lights suction cupped against the wall with that 54-inch screen in front of it. I made a window. Mm-hmm. With light coming through it. And then I just kept her off of the window a little bit, and I had to makeshift a window because It was terrible light. It was like the all that was available to me other than the, what I brought, which is also available to me, was the hotel lamps, which is not what we're going to use for pictures of getting ready. Right. Yeah.
Dixie, talk to me about that emotion of light, you know, the quality of light, the type of light you talked about before, light moving the way it does, mm-hmm. and all of a sudden you have the sun bursting in a certain spot, and that's a part of your style. How does light become a part of your style but help help within the scene that you're shooting or help make that subject look good?
Right. You know, I find that with photographing women, women tend to look really beautiful in backlight mm-hmm. because the sun is coming from the back, basically, and you can use a reflector to bounce light back into their face. So you get a nice catch light, and it just softens everything. And then the hair is also lit up. And then sometimes you'll get these nice little moments where the lens just hits that sunlight. You get a little bit of a flare. I just that kind of light just makes me really happy because it's just so flattering and so beautiful. But I've used all kinds of lights, from contrasting to or constant light to strobes to speed lights. We've used car headlights before to light a scene in a fog machine. That can tend to look really neat. Mm-hmm. I use a lot of fog machines because that creates a cool atmosphere in portraits. So there's so many tools, and that's really what makes it fun.
Jerry, you mentioned the ice light before as a steady light that you created. Talk a little bit about your light sources and how you're working light, because I know all of you probably use multiple types of light, but which are your favorites to work with to help?
I think my favorite light is what God gave us, and that is either sunlight or open shade or through a window. I mean, it's there, and you can work with it quickly. I mean, I could pimp the ice light right now, but I won't. I mean, certainly it's a beautiful light, and I should give you one because that would have solved your problem. Hashtag, I just pimped it. but I first work out, what am I trying to say? Mm-hmm. Lighting is really what you're trying to say.
Sure.
So really, it you know, if you want something masculine, you might get split lighting. You want something dramatic, you get the eyes in shadow. If you want something mysterious, you might go backlight. But I love sunlight. I actually work with it as well. So what I do is I look at my day and say, all right, if I'm going to be at this location, well, that's good for overcast. Well, overcast and soft lighting might be good for more animated shots, walking shots, because it's flooding everywhere. Well, I might do the romantic kissing or whispering in the ear, closing eyes in the sun, because that'll force the bride's face up into the sun. That'll be easy on the beach, for example. So I'll pace myself and work out where I'm going, but I'll use those tools in my, you know, in my experience to make it work. But lighting, posing, everything is all about what you're trying to say. Because after all, we're talking about portrait photography. It's not just what you look like, it's who you are. Mm-hmm. And the better you are as a craftsperson to with lighting and posing and your cropping and whatever you do in your camera, then you get that essence of that person. That could just be a little moment, and that's where it's at.
You know, with the majority of the work we do around the Ronald McDonald House, a lot of times we laugh with the children and the moms that we chase light around the house because it in the house, you mentioned that bulb that you don't want to shoot under.
Yep.
A lot of times I'm photographing under those bulbs.
Yeah.
And then we're looking for blinds at certain times of day, like 4 o'clock in the afternoon, where the light is streaming in and you can't plan it out or map it out better with your own light source. So it's natural and it works. A lot of times I tend to delve into the black and white side of that. And I think black and white versus color screams a different kind of mood within portraits. Start with you, Dixie. What do you prefer, black and white or color?
Always black and white.
And what are your thoughts?
I mean, love black and white portraits. With black and white, I feel like you get more to the soul of the person that you're shooting because you're not distracted by the clothes, essentially. So I think portraits especially come to life when you use black and white. Mm-hmm. You can shoot some beautiful in-camera black and whites using picture control and then all the Nikon cameras. And you can also light a lot more contrasty with black and white because there's not the color to worry about. You can create some really moody, neat black and white images. And I think, Jerry, you really rang home the fact that you got to consider your vision first.
Right.
Before you go into lighting a photograph, I think that's the biggest part of it, is just mm-hmm. finding that vision. Are you going for a moody image or a more happy, go-lucky, you know, all-around type of image? And that's going to dictate what kind of lighting you use.
I mean, Charmi, your pictures are based on color. I mean, the
all
beauty, the flowers, and those moments. So I would think the color within your pictures is something you consider all the time.
Yeah. So I love a good black and white photo. But for me, I am so in love with the richness of all my subject's skin, that color is just really important for me to keep in. And really the events that I'm shooting are very colorful. And so I want to keep that in. But even, you know, tighter portraits like this one, I love the richness of her skin, and I feel like you'd almost lose it in the black and white. And this is just, it says a lot about who she is, even though it's only the color of her skin. It's, you can see that there's like a history and there's a connection to other things there.
Mm. Dixie, you brought up picture control. Charmi, when it comes to white balance,
yeah,
and setting color within the camera, what are your preferences?
So when I was only shooting with DSLRs, I would only set my, I would set it to Kelvin if I was in a completely controlled light, or I would just use auto, because the auto on the D850 is so trustworthy. Mm-hmm. But when I'm shooting with the Z7, I can see exactly what I'm shooting. So you
make some fine tunes.
100%. I'm always tuning in my white balance on that, because I can see what I'm going to get and I can trust it, and it's perfect. So yeah, I would say with the mirrorless, I'm doing a lot more of dialing in my white balance.
Yeah, and you know, Jerry, you had mentioned mirrorless before. So if anybody who's used a mirrorless camera so far, the electronic viewfinder and seeing the picture, not only seeing the exposure before,
yeah,
it's happening. You know, you've got that down. You're seeing the color because the eyepieces are so accurate in color. Jerry, you and I sat down for literally 4 hours one day going through a mirrorless camera for the first time.
Yeah.
What are some of the technologies? Again, you could probably shoot a great portrait with a DSLR. You shoot a great portrait with mirrorless. What are some of the newer technologies? Talk a little bit more about that from what you started before.
So here's the thing. Like, using mirrorless for the first time was quite an epiphany, because, you know, if you haven't held it before, if you haven't used them before, but then when you look at the Nikon, almost a legendary menu system, like the it's so familiar. So what we discovered was the ability to actually look at your function buttons and change them to exactly what you want. And I'm sure every one of us will use them a little bit differently. Mm-hmm. But what I find exhilarating and incredible and makes me more efficient and makes it more fun is that with my eye to the camera, I can change the menu. I can actually get all my shortcuts to the My Menu section, which I think not many people use, which I think they should. So basically, there's a My Menu section where you can put all your favorite shortcuts rather than try to chase where you put all the stuff in the menu. So I can go into the My Menu with this finger, and then with this finger, this Function 2 button, I can, after I take the photograph, I can preview it, and then the AF on, I can zoom 100%. So now, for example, if we are shooting with a 105 1.4, sometimes it's a difficult lens to focus.
You may miss focus on the place you need it.
Yeah. So now with pinpoint focus, I can choose which part of the eye to focus on.
Right.
And let alone be able to go in there. So many of us, we might choose shoot 10 shots to hopefully get that one that works. You just take one shot, zoom up to it within a split second, and you've nailed it.
Right.
So it makes it more efficient, and I've never been so confident shooting at 1.4 ever before in my 25-year career. So it's amazing.
Dixie, anything about mirrorless that has changed the way you shoot in the way of portraits?
Absolutely. I think that, you know, I shoot on location a lot, so I'm always, you know, climbing down rocks to get to this beautiful beach location or whatever it is. So just the fact that it's so much more lightweight, but yet it's almost like a D850 in a smaller, more compact package. Mm-hmm. And so for shooting fashion, especially on location, it's a game changer. Mm-hmm. I have been blown away with the image quality that comes out of the Z6 and the Z7. Mm-hmm. And it's very interesting way of shooting it. It feels like a Nikon. It just feels right in your hands when you're shooting with it.
Right.
And I was literally scrolling through all the images from the shoot that we did a few months ago, and I did not see one that was out of focus. And a lot of times shooting at f1.4 or f1.8. So mind was blown.
Yeah, I remember when we were out on a location in Mejia, Texas. And we went to that abandoned place. One of the things I thought was so amazing, because it was my first time using mirrorless, was the detail of the light striking this metallic nice framework on the top of the house. As I'm dialing in my exposure, I'm seeing exactly how much highlight I want. And I just found that to be, you know, just an amazing benefit. And what about lenses in the mirrorless world? Does anything change here for you guys? Or
the 35-1.8 is... So I have a tendency to do extreme composition sometimes. The fact that I can have 90% focus coverage is already amazing, but that I can depend on it being sharp edge to edge, that's a big deal. That's not something you could always depend on with DSLRs, but with this new 35-1.8, I can always depend on that. So if I do have an extreme composition in mind or something that's spanning my composition, I can trust that it's going to be sharp all the way through.
Jerry, when you're talking about f1.4, there's not a lot of depth of field. How much is edge sharpness importance? That what is the importance of that to you?
I have a very low tolerance for lack of sharpness. I think there's some, you know, many photographers are okay with it. I'm not. Like, if the eye that's closest to the camera not in focus, for me, it's practically deleted unless I can replace it with something else. So for me, it's critical. I want to go right in there. And speaking of the 35mm 1.8, I've never used that lens in my career. And having it recently, I'm like, oh, let me play with this. And then I decided to actually use it, like back in the day when I used to shoot medium format and black and white 35mm on my Nikon FM2. I actually shot a recent wedding with the D5 and the Z6 on my hip. I literally kept it on 1.8 and black and white, and I started using it as a photojournalistic sort of go-to camera, and it's sort of opening up these worlds and reminding me of how I grew up in photography. So, like I said, it's I've always had fun, but it's actually a lot more fun shooting mirrorless these days. So
back to the more the emotional side, or, you know, looking at other work. When I went through college, I was fascinated by painters and looking at the portraits that painters did. So I always relied on that as sort of that place to go for inspiration on the types of portraits that I wanted to make. Peter Paul Rubens and some of the action in the work and the portraits that were done by artists. Dixie, talk a little bit about who influences you as a photographer and share that with these people, somebody, people to look at to maybe grow your inspiration for portrait photography.
Gosh, I feel like I find inspiration everywhere. I find a lot of inspiration when I travel, different cultures, submersing yourself in different cultures. And I also think you learn a lot about yourself as a photographer when you travel, just from seeing the light in different places. I mean, I did a shoot in Brazil, and the light was so warm and beautiful there. And, you know, just having that opportunity to see different places, I think, really inspires a lot of the lighting in my portraits. And then I also take a lot of inspiration from all the old-fashioned masters of photography, Irving Penn and Richard Avedon and the classics. You know, they do all this beautiful black and whites, and there's just so much inspiration out there, and just having that opportunity is really fun.
Yeah, for me, Herb Ritz, Annie Leibovitz were two of the photographers I follow back then. Jerry, who's influenced you?
Well, you just stole my thunder. Herb Ritz, he was...
I didn't do it intentionally.
I know. It's all good, but Herb Ritz for me was... Obviously, he's passed away, and that was very terrible when it happened many, many years ago. But what I loved about what he did, it was just so simple. It was often just sunlight on a white background, blank canvas, you create something. I've got to say, Joe McNally, what I'm inspired about this week, Joe has actually been here every day, and he's actually witnessed most of the talks. And this is a legend in our industry. He's sitting in the front row, hanging on every word that we say, adding to his knowledge, which... I'm sure all of us three are like, hey, what's he going to learn from us? So having the likes and legends of Joe and the like to be able to still know that it's a never-ending journey. You can never learn everything. It's just impossible. But that's part of the joy of it.
So I know you do something very special to inspire yourself, and it's in your bedroom.
Cool.
But I'm not. We did it. Let's take it back. Let's reel it in.
I don't know what you're referring to.
Part of the photo shoot in your bedroom.
Right.
You have a stand. And what's on the stand?
Absolutely. So Annie Leibovitz, well, Helmut Newton released this Taschen book called the Sumo Book. It was the first of its kind. It was huge. And I wanted to buy it. And it was something like $5,000-$6,000 or whatever it was. And I'm like, I want to buy it. Then 2 years later, I'm like, all right, I'll buy it. It went up $2,000. Then I'm like, ugh. And I'm like, all right, let me buy it. And he passed away before I could buy it. Then it went to $20,000. I'm like, oh. Anyway, finally, Annie Leibovitz, who I'm sure we all respect and admire, I bought her Sumo book from Taschen, and it sits in our bedroom. And basically, every day I'll turn a page and just walk past and marvel at the lighting or the cinematic quality of the photographs and the uniqueness, the subtle quality of the colors and the pastels and what she does, I think, is amazing. So, yeah.
Charmi, who would you recommend people
look
at?
I'm going to be human with you for a second and tell you that as soon as you asked this question, my brain went completely empty of all the names I know ever in the world.
So, it's okay.
I will confess that, but you can't tell her that Dixie's on my list. No, didn't say it.
You're on my list, girl.
No, that never happened. But also, I think, actually, there's one up here. I like to look at a lot of old art. There's actually a portrait in this that's playing behind us that's my version of a much more mature, knowing girl with a pearl earring. Mm-hmm. So I feel like when I looked at too many photographers' work too deeply, I would start mimicking them too closely, mm-hmm. and I never want to do that. So I actually spend a lot of time looking at like old art and seeing how the old painters used to use light in their paintings, and then I run with it.
I would recommend highly for anybody here, or if you're tuning in, on the schedule we have the Instagram accounts of every speaker that's speaking here, and on our ambassador pages we have the Instagram accounts. And even as a culture within our company now, we spread that out. It doesn't matter whether you're working accounting or, you know, in the repair department, to go look at pictures to be inspired every day. So as we start to wind this down, I'm going to start with you, Dixon. We'll work across. Talk to me about how you share your pictures, the importance of social, mm-hmm. and how you would recommend if people want to get their photos out there, what should they be doing?
Yeah, I mean, today we have such an amazing opportunity to share our images with the world, because social is just so prominent in this world now. Mm-hmm. When I was first starting out, you know, I started out on film. So showing our pictures was a matter of, hey, do you want to come by? Can I bring my portfolio by and show you all my images? Right. Well, now it's such an interesting process that we can put it out there in the world. I think the biggest thing is people like to know, not only see the picture, but know the story behind it. Mm-hmm. And so I think when you're sharing your images, I think it's important to give people a little bit of a context, mm-hmm. To how it was created. I mean, people love seeing the behind the scenes of what you create as a photographer and your vision and how you brought that to life. So just sharing that part of it and the storyline behind the image, I think is really important.
What are your top social platforms?
I would say top social platform, my favorite's Instagram, because it's all about images.
Mm-hmm. So you're saying then within the caption you give details of how you made the picture and yes. educate a little bit too.
Yeah.
Jerry, where are people going to look at your work?
You go to jerryghionis.com, and that sort of gets you to anywhere you pretty much want to go. I've also been teaching online now for 11 years, which I'm really excited about. But Instagram, certainly. I share my images there. But I find that social media being a necessary evil, I actually get, sometimes I need a break. I literally got to walk away for a month, because sometimes when I think many of us, you know, many of us sitting in this room, I think everyone in the world, what we do is we compare ourselves with the best photographs and the best meals, the best locations and destinations that every friend of yours has ever gone, and you start looking at yourself and like, oh, my life is so disinterested, like not interesting, because you're only sharing the best parts of your life. Mm-hmm. I think sometimes it's good to share your vulnerability as well.
Right.
And I think it makes you more approachable. So I think it's important that you don't only show your best work, you show the challenges that you had to overcome, and maybe you show a before and after. This is what I had to work with and this is what I got from it, and actually gives people hope and also becomes not only a photo that's fun to share, but it's a learning experience. So I'm a teacher at heart too, so I think that the learning experience is always important to share.
Mm-hmm. And I notice that when you're sharing your work, you've kept it simple with your name. Some people try to get super creative. Charmi, your handle for Instagram is up there. It's Charmi Pena, right? You keep it direct so people
yeah.
know who you are, and it's branding you,
yeah.
right? It's part of your branding?
Yeah, so when it comes to branding, actually, my Instagram feed is very consistently just work. I get very distressed if someone's like, I need you to put something on social for me. I'm like, no, I can't. You're going to ruin my grid. So I like to keep it really consistent so you can see who I am photographically, at least. Mm-hmm. And then I use my stories to get across to people what I'm doing, the things I'm loving right now, if I'm hanging out with my family, or I got a new lens I'm obsessed with, or lately I've been using Instagram stories to put together a full animated story of a single wedding.
I saw what you did. You
yeah.
showed me on your phone there. That's terrific.
That one saved right now as like one of my highlights. But, you know, that's where, in the stories is where I'm trying to let them get to know me. And where I'll show before and afters, and where I'll show them, you know, what I'm struggling with and how we overcame it, mm-hmm. my fake window lights. So I use my grid as just like a really clear place for people to see who I am as a brand and as a photographer. And then I use my stories so that they can get to know who I am as a person.
Right. So one of the things we've done after each of the panel discussions was roll into a more deeper discussion, a presentation with one individual, and that individual is Dixie Dixon. So what we'd like to do, first of all, thank you guys. The insight, amazing again. We've so much going on here, and I know there's lots of pixels and, you know, electronic things going on and, you know, robots and people talking back to you that aren't standing there. It's just, it's pretty wild here. But to connect with photography, I think it's still a big thing. It's a big part of Nikon. So thank you for sharing your insights. Dixie, you typically do what before you come up and present? Take it away from you.
I always meditate before I come on stage and speak so I can be fully present.
Can you meditate with 7,500 people watching us?
I don't know if I can sit Indian style on this chair.
So what we'd like to do now, please hang in there. We're going to take the chairs off the stage, and we're going to let you roll right into your program.
Okay.
What's the title of your program?
Lights, Camera, Fashion.
Lights, Camera, Fashion. So stick around. Guys, thank you again. Thank you guys
thank
for tuning
so
in and listening. And let's clear this up and get